have a deep word this morning, amen, but I have a practical word, amen. And as I was, you know, praying about what to speak on, and I like to think about what's going on around us as far as holidays and things in the natural.
Yes, yes.
And I shared that before. So with Memorial Day being tomorrow, I wanted to speak about honor. Amen.
All right,
I wanted to speak on honor. Because we know Memorial Day is a day that we honor those who made the ultimate sacrifice.
Yes.
Amen. And we know oftentimes when you see memorial images, you see one like this that says, remember and honor.
Right.
Or you see one that says, some gave all gave some, and some gave all.
Yes.
That's referencing the sacrifices that some made, and then some made the ultimate sacrifice, giving their lives, amen, so that we can have the freedoms that we have.
Yes,
that
yes.
we most times take for granted. We rarely take the time to think about why we are able to do certain things.
Yes.
But there are people that make those sacrifices, amen. And so I want to just take the time to honor Bishop Payne because he served
yes.
in our armed forces, amen.
Yes.
And we just want to thank him for his service.
Yes.
And we want to thank everybody, everywhere, for the service
yes.
That they gave so that we can enjoy the freedom that we take for granted.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes,
so just for a few minutes, I'm not going to be here for you long, but just for a few minutes, I'm going to be speaking on the forgotten art of honor. The forgotten art of honor. Amen. How many of us know we live in a day where honor seems to be a lost art?
Come on now.
People don't honor themselves, let alone honoring somebody else. It's a lost art.
Yes.
But if we look in the Word of God, we will see that honor is a very important thing. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very important thing to God. Amen. We must honor those who make sacrifices for us. Amen.
Yes.
We must realize that there are those who make sacrifices and those who have made sacrifices
mm-hmm.
so that we can enjoy the things that we have. We oftentimes take for granted things that we have, and we act like the things that we have were supposed to happen. We act like the way that things are,
yes.
they're supposed to be that way.
Yes.
We forget that there are people that made these things that we enjoy possible.
Well.
Amen. And we have to know that we can't afford to take anything for granted.
No.
We can't afford to take not one single thing for granted because the things that we have,
mm-hmm.
we could easily not have them.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We could easily not have them. So we can't take for granted the things that we have, but we can't even take for granted the things that we don't have.
Right.
Amen. Yes. It's a blessing to not have some things. Amen.
Yes. Yes.
We take into consideration that there are people who have ailments, people that have situations that are drastic. Amen.
Uh-huh.
And it's a blessing to us
yes.
to not be in the state that they're in. Amen. So we can't even take for granted the things that we don't have.
Amen.
We have to realize that there are people who would love to be in our shoes.
Yes.
There are people who would love to be in our shoes, no matter how grim you think your situation is.
Yes, Lord.
No matter how grim you think your situation to be, we have to realize that it could always, always be worse.
That's right.
No matter how bad it is, it could be worse than it is.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
I'll go a step further. No matter how bleak you think your circumstance is, there is somebody with it worse
yes.
right now.
Yes.
No matter how bad you think you got it, there's somebody somewhere right now with a worse situation.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. Somebody somewhere would trade places with me. Somebody would trade places with you.
All right.
Without a second thought.
Yes.
Yes,
Lord.
Yes.
They would trade places with us without a second thought
mm-hmm.
because to them our situation looks way better.
Yes.
But we sit here soaking in our sorrow, thinking that our situation is so bad.
All right, all right.
Now, it may be true that our situation may not be ideal.
Yes.
It may not be the ideal situation.
Uh-huh.
And it maybe what we're going through, whatever the hardships we're going through, maybe we don't deserve them. Amen. But we have to realize that we're still alive. Amen.
Yes.
Every moment above, or every day, as the saying says, above the grave, is a blessing, amen? And when we're still breathing, we have to know that God is still with us, amen?
Amen.
As long as we're breathing, we have a purpose, amen?
Yes, God.
As long as we're breathing, we are valuable to God. Amen.
Yes.
So we have to keep going. Amen.
Amen.
That's just an opener. As I said, we're going to talk about honor, but just for a few minutes. Amen.
Amen.
Exodus 20, verse 2 through 5. It says, I am the Lord thy God, which hath brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. This is God speaking. He says in verse 3, thou shalt have no other gods before me.
Yes.
Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image,
all right,
or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above,
mm-hmm,
or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth.
All right.
Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 7 says, thou shalt not take the name of thy Lord, thy God, in vain. As I said, we're going to talk about honor. Well, the first command given by God to honor, even though it doesn't use the word honor,
mm-hmm,
but the first command given by God concerning honor was given concerning himself.
Yes.
Amen. In the scriptures that we just read, God is talking to the Israelites, amen, who he's chosen to be his people. Amen. He says to them, I am the one who brought you out of bondage.
All right.
He says, I am the one who redeemed you. I have made you my people. Because of that, you should honor me.
Amen.
He said, you should place nothing and no one before me.
Yes.
I am your God. He says, do not make for yourself an idol of anything.
Yes.
And do not use my name improperly or in an irrelevant manner.
Right.
That's what it means to use God's name in vain.
Right.
It's not when you're using it in the way that it's supposed to be, when you're not honoring it. Amen.
Yes.
When you honor somebody, you acknowledge what they've done for you.
Amen.
When you honor someone, you appreciate what they've done for you.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
When you honor someone, you place no one before them.
Yes.
When you honor someone, you hold them in high esteem. You reverence them.
Yes.
Amen. We honor and we reverence God because it is he who redeemed us. We acknowledge that he made us his people, just like he spoke to the Israelites.
Yes.
In the Old Testament, in the New Testament, we acknowledge that he made us his people.
Yes.
He purchased us with a price.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says he bought us out of darkness and transferred us into his kingdom.
Yes.
So that word transferred means that was all his doing. We had nothing to do with it. Amen.
Yes.
He transferred us into his kingdom.
Yes.
There's a story of a young girl who was embarrassed by her mother's ugly face. She was embarrassed until her mother explained to her how she got that ugly face.
All right.
It happened when she rescued her daughter from a fire that would have killed the daughter. From that point on, from the point when the mother told her story to her daughter about how her face got disfigured, from that moment on, the daughter began to consider her mother's face beautiful because she understood that her mother's face got that way because she made a sacrifice for her. She sacrificed her beauty to save her life. Amen.
Yes.
That's when she began to honor her mother because she understood that her mother made a sacrifice for her. This story here illustrates sacrifices that parents make for their children.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Mothers and fathers will sacrifice most things for their children. Amen.
Yes.
But this story also illustrates God's love for us.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Isaiah 53 records how Jesus expressed his love for us.
Yes.
Yes.
Isaiah writes, he possessed no splendid form for us to see, no desirable appearance. He was despised and avoided by others.
Yes.
A man who suffered, who knew sickness well. This is talking about Jesus.
Yes.
Like someone from whom people hid their faces. He was despised, and we didn't think about him. We didn't even consider the fact that what Jesus did, the people at that time, didn't even consider the fact that he was doing it for them.
Amen.
And even today, we don't think about, well, most people don't think about the fact that what Jesus did, he did so that we could be made right with God. Amen?
Yes.
That's why we're here this morning, because of the sacrifice that Jesus made so that we could be right with God. Amen?
Yes.
It says, it was certainly for our sicknesses.
Uh-huh.
It was certainly our sicknesses that he carried.
Yes.
And our sufferings that he bore.
Yes.
But we saw him afflicted, struck down by God, and tormented.
Well,
the people that saw Jesus get the torment that he got,
yes,
they thought it was because he was being afflicted by God. They thought he was suffering because he was, we know when we read the New Testament,
okay,
the people that crucified Jesus thought that he was blaspheming when he said that he was the Son of God.
Yes.
They didn't take into consideration that he was doing this for you.
Amen.
Amen. They considered him afflicted by God.
Yes.
But he was doing this on their behalf, on our behalf. Amen.
Yes.
Yes.
It says he was pierced because of our rebellions and crushed. And crushed because of our crimes.
Yes.
He bore the punishment that made us whole. By his wounds we are healed.
Yes, we are.
But then it goes on to say, it says, like sheep we have all wandered away, each going his way. We all can testify to that. At one time, before knowing God, we all did our own thing.
Yes.
We didn't have a consideration of the fact of what Jesus did. Amen. We did what we wanted to do.
Yes.
Amen. But God put on him the punishment for all of our crimes.
Yes,
amen.
Yes,
it says, like sheep, we have all wandered away, each going his own way, but the Lord let fall on him all of our crimes.
Yes.
But the Lord wanted to crush him and to make him suffer. If his life is offered as a restitution, he will see his offspring, that's talking about us, and he will enjoy long life.
Yes.
The Lord's plans will come to fruition through him. God's plans of salvation for man will come to fruition through Jesus Christ.
Yes.
It says, after his deep anguish, he will see light and he will be satisfied. Through his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will make many righteous and will bear their guilt. It was our sins that Jesus carried, amen?
Yes,
it was our guilt that he bore.
Yes.
And it pleased God to crush him.
My God.
It didn't please God as in making God happy. But it pleased him, it satisfied him.
Yes, yes.
Jesus was the perfect sacrifice that offered up to God what we couldn't offer up, amen.
Amen?
So it pleased God, it satisfied God to crush Jesus on our behalf so that we could be made right with God, amen.
Amen.
God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, as the scripture says, amen. So knowing the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, we honor him. Amen. We're talking about honor.
Amen.
Honor begins with God. Amen.
Yes,
honor
right.
begins with God.
Yes.
But then, because honor begins with God, it trickles down to us.
Yes.
Where we honor ourselves,
yes,
and then we honor one another. Amen.
Yes,
amen.
Yes,
the second command. Now, the first command to honor was given in Exodus 20 by God concerning himself.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Then the second command to honor was also given in Exodus 20, but it was concerning parents, amen? So as I said, honor begins with God,
yes,
then it trickles down to us.
Amen.
We honor ourselves, and then we honor one another, amen?
Yes.
So in verse 12, God says, honor your father and your mother,
yes,
so that you may have a long life in the land,
yes,
that the Lord your God has given to you,
yes,
has given you. This I said before, God was speaking to the Israelites with the first command. He was also speaking to them with the second command, amen? But he was speaking to the children. He said, honor your father and your mother.
Yes,
he gave this to them as he was delivering them out of the bondage of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
Amen. And he was bringing them into a land that he was giving them.
Yes.
Amen. Here we see that it's important that we honor our parents. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus reiterated this,
uh-huh,
when he was asked by the rich young ruler. We know the rich young ruler came to Jesus and he said,
yes,
good teacher, what must I do that I may inherit eternal,
yes,
life?
Uh-huh.
Jesus said to him six things. He said, do not murder.
All right.
Do not commit adultery.
Uh-huh.
Do not steal.
Yes.
Do not bear false witness.
Yes.
Do not defraud. And the last thing Jesus said was honor your father and your mother.
Yes.
This is necessary to enter into the kingdom of God. Amen. So we see there that honor is important to God.
Yes, Lord.
But again, the Apostle Paul reiterated this again to the Ephesian church.
Uh-huh.
He said in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1 through 3, he says, children, obey your parents in the Lord,
yes,
because this is right. Honor your father and your mother,
yes,
which is the first commandment with a promise,
amen,
so that it may go well with you,
uh-huh,
that you may have a long life in the land.
Yes.
Parents deserve honor,
yes,
because God says so.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, 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 yes.
Parents deserve honor because as I, the story I shared, parents sometimes make sacrifices for their children that they don't, that they will never understand. Fact of the matter is, no matter what you do for your kids, sometimes they don't think, they're going to think that you don't do enough. I'm looking at her now because no matter how many times I say yes to something she wants, the one time I say no, I'm the worst dad. She says, you're shaking your head at me. She said, you never say yes. You forget all the times I say yes before because I say no, because I said no this time. So children will never understand the sacrifices that their parents make for them. Amen?
Amen.
The command to honor your parents, though, it comes attached with a promise. The promise was that if you do honor your parents,
all right,
that it will go well with you,
yes,
and that your life will be long. Amen?
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Now, this may not be true, but this is just the way that I think. I'm thinking we live in such a time right now where there's such disrespect.
Yes.
There's such dishonor among people, among parents and children, that could that be the reason why there's so much death? I'm not saying that it is, but I'm just questioning. God said, honor your mother and your father that your life may be long.
Yes.
Well, if we live in such a time of dishonor and disrespect, could this be? Just questioning. Could it be why there's so much death amongst our young people?
Amen.
I mean, it stands to reason God said to honor, your life will be long. Well, if you dishonor, your life can be short. Just a question. But the promise was if you honor your parents, your life will be long. Amen?
Yes, Lord.
So we're going to honor our parents because God says so. Amen?
Amen?
Honor is important to God.
Yes, it is.
But as I said, not only is there an honor of respect shown between children and parents, there's a lack of mutual respect. As I say, the honor starts with God, then it comes to us, and then it comes to, we give it to one another. There's a lack of mutual respect among people.
Yes, Lord.
There's a lack of mutual affection. There's a lack of mutual honor,
yes,
among people. Amen? We see it all the time on the news. We see viral videos of,
yes,
people fighting, of people near death. There's a lack of honor because people would rather videotape what's going on than help.
All right.
You could be in an accident about to die and somebody will pull out their cell phone and record what's going on rather than using that cell phone to call an ambulance or to call emergency. They will videotape it. There's a lack of honor. Who would rather watch what's going on than assist?
Amen. Amen.
This is to be expected in the world. But it shouldn't be going on in the church, amen?
Amen.
But we see videos of people exposing people when they're trying to get right with the Lord. I shared with Tina, there was a video of a man, he got up and he was testifying and confessing his sins, amen? He was talking about how much bad he did and how he was convicted and he realized that he needed to get right with the Lord. He could no longer do the things that he was doing. But somebody videotaped that man's confession, that man's getting right. And the video went viral. Now everybody knows what this man did, what he was trying to get his heart rid of, because they wanted to make a viral video. Somebody shared this. But this was this man's attempt to get right with God. So these things, this lack of honor should not be going on in the church. We can expect it in the world,
amen,
but it shouldn't be going on in the church, amen? We can expect the world to be the world, and the world is going to be the world, amen? But at the same time, the church has to be the church. In the church, we honor one another. In the church, we love one another, amen? Because it's important to God, so it should be important to us.
Amen.
As the church, we love one another, as I said. As the church, we don't compete with one another. As the church, we should seek to complete one another.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
The scripture says that every joint supplies.
Mm-hmm.
That means, that's talking about us as being the body of Christ.
Yes. Yes.
That means that we're supposed to supply what each other needs. Amen?
Yes, Lord.
If we were to compete, though, it should be in who can uplift one another.
Amen.
Who can encourage one another? Who can honor one another
Yes,
for?
Yes, Lord.
Romans 12 and 10 says, love one another deeply as brothers and sisters.
Yes.
Then it says, outdo one another in showing honor.
All right, now.
So if we're supposed to compete, it's supposed to be in uplifting one another, yes, and honoring one another. We can compete, but it's in me honoring you and in you honoring me.
Amen.
Who can outdo each other in that?
Amen.
Amen. Our competition should be in esteeming one another.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
Philippians 2 and 3 says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit.
All right.
But in humility,
yes,
consider others as more important than yourself.
That's the word. That's the
we're
word.
Supposed to consider, I'm supposed to consider you more important than me.
All right,
and you're supposed to consider me more important to you.
Right.
If we do that, nobody feels left out.
Yes. Yes, 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 yes.
Nobody feels overlooked. If I'm seeking to esteem you and you're seeking to esteem me, we both get encouraged.
Yes,
amen.
Yes,
yes. Yes, no.
We don't look down on one another.
Amen. Amen.
We're supposed to look up to one another.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
That's honor.
Yes, Lord.
Now, as I begin talking about Memorial Day. Amen. On Memorial Day, a lot of people barbecue. A lot of people,
yes,
take it as a day of relaxation. But really, Memorial Day is a day of honor.
Yes.
As I said earlier, we're to honor on Memorial Day those people who made sacrifices for us.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Those people who gave their lives in active military service. Amen.
Yes, Lord.
They gave their lives that we might enjoy the freedom that we take for granted. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
There were men and women who laid down their lives because they thought freedom was important. Jesus laid down his life so that we could be free.
Yes.
The word of God says it is for freedom,
yes, Lord, yes,
that you have been set free. For the fact of freedom,
yes, Lord,
that's why Jesus died, so that we can be set free from the requirements of the law. Amen?
Amen.
These men and women gave their lives so that we can be free, so that we can enjoy the freedom that we take for granted. Amen.
Uh-huh.
Because of that, we honor them. They didn't give their lives because they had to. They didn't even necessarily give their lives because they wanted to.
All right.
But they gave their lives as a sacrifice.
Yes,
amen.
Lord. Yes,
so
Lord.
So for that, we honor them. Amen.
Yes,
amen.
Lord.
Amen.
Yes, Lord. We honor. Yes. Lord.
Romans 13 and 7 says, render to all what is due to them.
Yes.
Tax to whom tax. Custom to whom custom. Fear to whom fear. Honor,
yes,
to whom honor.
Yes, Lord.
We render to these men and women who gave their lives the honor that's due to them. Amen.
Yes.
Now, when I prepare a sermon, I don't ever know who's going to be here, so I try to just, in my mind, imagine who was going to be here and try to speak to anybody,
amen,
where they are. Amen?
Amen.
That's what you're supposed to do as,
yes,
when you're getting the word together. You're not supposed to be getting together for yourselves or for an ideal person. There's somebody, or you're supposed to be imagining that there's somebody,
yes,
that needs,
amen,
something from the Lord. So you're trying to speak,
yes,
to everybody.
Yes.
The,
yes,
young, the old,
amen,
the rich, the poor, the happy, the sad,
yes,
you're trying to speak to anybody. So as I was preparing this word, I was just thinking and hoping that there would be somebody here who had a loved one that maybe sacrificed their life in this way.
Yes, yes.
And maybe remembering or thinking about their loved one, amen. So I had gathered some scriptures just to encourage their heart, amen.
Yes, yes.
And I'm going to share them, amen. Psalms 34 and 18 says, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit.
Yes.
Proverbs 10 and 7 says, the memory of the righteous is blessed, but the name of the Lord, but the name of the wicked will rot. If you're righteous, your memory is blessed. Amen.
Yes.
Psalm 116 and 15 says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his godly one.
Yes.
God takes no pleasure in anybody who wicked who dies. So we have to rid ourselves of the idea that when people are dying out in the street, getting killed because and their lives don't line up with the Lord, God takes no pleasure in that. His desire is that they would get right, amen?
Amen.
He takes no pleasure in them dying, but he does take pleasure in the death of his righteous ones. Why? Because they're coming to be with him.
Amen.
Amen. John 15, 13 says, greater love no one has than this, than that one laid down his life for his friends. Amen.
Yes.
1 Thessalonians 2 through 3 says, we thank God for you all, making mention of you constantly in our prayers. We recall in the presence of God and our Father,
yes,
the work produced by your faith,
yes,
your labor motivated by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
As I said, these people didn't give their lives because they wanted to.
All right.
or because they had to, but they gave their life as a sacrifice. That takes faith. That I'm doing something that's going to make a difference. That's why these people gave their lives. Amen. 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 14 says, "We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, concerning those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve like the rest who have no hope." For we believe that Jesus died and rose again in the same way through Jesus, God will bring those who have fallen asleep.
Amen.
We have to know that God knows when we have loved ones that have sacrificed their lives.
Yes, yes.
He knows how much we love them.
Yes.
And he knows how much we miss them. Amen.
Yes, yes, Lord.
We have to know that God understands. He is near you. Whenever you're remembering your loved ones, whenever you're thinking of the sacrifice that they made, he is near you at that time. The scripture says he's near to the brokenhearted.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
And he says the memory of the righteous is blessed. So you can cherish the memories that you have of your loved ones. Amen.
Amen.
Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his godly one. God holds with great value the death of those who are his. Amen.
Yes.
He doesn't treat the death of our loved ones lightly because they're his loved ones as well.
Yes.
Amen. Anybody who has lost a loved one as a sacrifice, who gave their life as a sacrifice for us, know that we are praying for them. Amen.
Amen.
And know that if their loved one was saved, that they will see their loved ones again. Amen. The scripture says that if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, then we also know and believe that he's going to bring your loved one with him when he returns. Amen?
Amen.
So we have hope. Paul says, don't mourn like those who don't have hope.
Amen.
As if you won't see your loved one again. If your loved one is saved, you will see them again. So it's okay to mourn.
Amen.
But don't mourn like you don't have any hope. Amen.
Yes.
We have hope because we believe that Jesus is going to bring those who have fallen asleep again with him.
Yes.
Amen. Now on a lighter note, as I was praying and studying and thinking about what I was going to speak about, so I looked up what Memorial Day really was. As I said, Memorial Day is a day of honoring those who sacrificed their life. But in the natural, also, Memorial Day marks the beginning of summer.
All right.
It signifies the beginning of summer, amen?
Yes, yes.
And we all know that in the natural, there are four seasons. We have winter, we have spring, we have summer, and we have fall, amen? Memorial Day signifies the beginning of summer. So I'm saying, okay, Lord, so if Memorial Day signifies the beginning of summer, what you trying to say? Amen. So I looked into it, and there are spiritual seasons as well. Amen. Now, we're all either currently in a season, or we're all coming out of a season, or we're all about to go into a season. You're either currently in, you're either coming out, or you're about to go into a season, amen?
Yes.
Each season that we go through, there's a reason that we go through it.
Yes.
And whatever season we in, we learn, we grow, and we learn to trust God more.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
We've all gone through fall seasons, amen? Fall seasons are a season where it seems like things are falling away.
Yes.
Seems like people are falling away. It seems like resources are falling away.
Yes.
But what's actually going on is we have to change our perspective because things aren't falling away. We are in a season actually of letting go.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
As we look at fall in the natural, we see the trees letting go of their leaves. Amen.
Yes.
In our fall season, we're in a season of letting go. Amen. This is where God wants us to be. Amen. We have to know that we're letting go of things. Amen.
Yes.
When you're letting go of things, they're not meant to go with you into your next season.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
We all went through winter seasons. Amen. Now we know in the natural it's cold. And in the winter season in the natural, we stay in the house.
Yes.
We seek to bundle up. And we know in the winter season, the ground is hard.
Yes.
Plants die, grass doesn't grow, all that kind of thing. In our winter season, we also feel like we're not growing.
All right.
We feel like we're not blooming.
Mm-hmm.
But what's actually going on, if we look at it in the way that God wants us to look at it, it's a time of rest.
Yes.
Our winter season is a time of rest. It's a time where we're supposed to get ideas and plans from God. Amen.
Yes.
So that when our spring comes, we can be able to plant the thing that God has given us in our winter. So in our winter, we're supposed to be receiving plans and ideas from God so that when our spring comes, we can plant those things and those ideas that God has given us. Amen? So when our spring arrives, just like in the natural, when spring comes, we're happy. It gets warm, we feel good, we get happy. That's the same way we are in the spirit. When our spring arrives in the spirit, we have a zest for life. Amen? We are excited. That's the same way it is in the spirit. We're excited because of our spring. Amen?
Amen?
When we enter into our spring, we have the feeling of being unstoppable. We feel like God is with us. Amen?
Amen?
We feel like we can do some things when we're in our spiritual spring.
Yes, Lord.
Amen? That's because God is with us. And his presence is being felt even more because we're coming out of our winter. Amen?
Yes,
and we're entering into our spring.
Yes,
in our spring is when we step out on faith. As I said, we plant the ideas God has given us in the winter.
Yes.
Amen. So in our spring, we step out on faith and we plant what God has given us in our winter. And then we begin to see the early stages of the blooming of the ideas and relationships that God has given us. Amen.
Amen.
And then, as I said, there's our summer.
Yes.
In our summer, it's just like in the natural. In the natural, in the summer, we mix work and play. We go to work, but we go on vacation.
Yes.
We go to work, but we take trips. That's the same way it is in our spiritual summer, amen?
Yes.
In our natural summer, we experience warmness and we experience coolness.
Yes.
That's the same way it is in the spirit, amen?
Yes, no.
In the summer, we work diligently, as I said, but we take vacations. This is symbolic. Symbolic of what? That in our summer season, we reap what God has has given us in our spring, but we also continue to sow.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
We continue to work, but we also make time to refresh and to relax.
Amen.
But our spiritual summer also is a time to get rid of distractions. Amen?
Yes, Lord. Yes.
We know like in a winter, we get out and we want to prepare our gardens and make our gardens nice, but it's the same way in our spiritual summer.
Yes, Lord.
It's time to limit ourselves to the distractions of the things that get us off kilter of what God is trying to show us and where God is trying to take us.
Amen.
So with all that being said, while I was preparing this message, God began to minister to me that just like Memorial Day signifies the beginning of summer, for us who are receiving, this also signifies the beginning of our spiritual summer.
Yes,
amen.
Yes,
it signifies a time where we are about to receive the things that God has given us, the things that we planted, the things that we sown. Now is the time for us to begin to reap those things, amen?
Yes,
and if you will receive it, I declare and I decree over us that this will be a season. God said this to me, this is a season of diligent work, but it's also a